Welcome to Open Mic on KGPR. Welcome to Open Mic on KGPR. This is Mr. Douglas. We're joined today by Stu Cook, bass player and one of the founding members of Creedence Clearwater Revival. Stu and Doug Clifford have carried on the torch of CCR with their touring group Creedence Clearwater Revisited and are playing in Great Falls this Saturday as part of the Montana State Fair. Welcome to the show, Stu.
Patrick, good to talk to you.
To the casual CCR fan, they go into this live show wondering how this incarnation of the band stacks up to the classic lineup that everybody grew up with. Talk a little bit about the guys in this lineup today and what people can expect from the show.
Well, when Doug and I, Cosmo, Creedence drummer, and I put together the band, when we came up with the concept, we thought, we didn't even know if we could succeed, because we were going to be pretty hard critics about this, having been in the original band from the very beginning. So, after we put the lineup in place, John Tristeo on lead vocals. The original guitar player was Elliot Easton from the Cars. Kurt Griffey is our guitar player now. Steve Gunner on keys and acoustic guitar, percussion. We wouldn't have taken this project out of our studio if we didn't think that it stood up. We have a lot of pride in the original band's work. It was an amazing career, and it just didn't make any sense for us to go out and just have people tear us up because it wasn't solid, and we wouldn't have done it had we not believed that it was something that the fans would really, really enjoy. And 18 years later, I have to say, I'm glad we did. We took a step off the ledge and can have, I think, established ourselves around the world now as a premier Creedence experience. It doesn't hurt that two of the guys are original members.
Right, right. Original rhythm section. I mean, come on.
Yeah, well, you know, that's it was. As I look back on all the people I've sat in with and Creedence renditions that I've heard, the rhythm section is probably the thing that's the most lacking. I've heard people play guitar and approximate the vocals, but no one plays with the feel that Cosmo and I do. So I think that's what people probably subliminally identify with, is that when we start playing, I mean, they recognize the guitar riff, but they know from the way Doug and I are playing together that it feels like Creedence.
Well, and going back to what you're saying, you know, you guys, this Revisited has been around for almost 20 years. I mean, really, how satisfying is it for you to have been able to put this together and just really make it work for so long?
Well, anytime you got something that lasts that long, you have to wonder what, you know, we've probably long forgotten the pain of the first couple of years when everybody said, or many people said, that this couldn't or shouldn't be done. But we listened to the fans, and you know, no one had been playing Creedence music. None of the members have been playing it since the band broke up, really, back in the 1970s, early 70s. So there was a whole new generation, at least one whole new generation of fans that found it a great thing to do, to come to a live Creedence concert and hear the music the way that they know it. You know, like it is on the records. So we're blessed. We're really happy. We're probably having more fun this year than we did last year, and so it goes and has gone from the beginning. It gets easier and easier every year we're here. There is more enthusiasm around the world for what we're doing. That's a good thing.
Well, and the term Southern rock is thrown around a lot. It's become very popular. It's a popular term for bands with that kind of just down home rocking sound, like the barbecue sound. I mean, you'll hear people talk about Skynyrd and the Allman Brothers for good reason, but you guys were really one of the true pioneers of this sound, I guess, despite being from the West Coast. I mean, how do you look back on helping to put an entire genre on a map?
Right, I think it was originally called Swamp Rock, wasn't it? Which,
from the swamps of San Francisco.
right, the sloughs of the Sacramento River. those are media generated boxes that make it easy for people to reference. But it's just, you know, it's down home. It is barbecue music. It is. I've never heard it put like that. That's a good term. But it's pure American. It's a blend of blues and country, some hillbilly thrown in, you know, bluegrass. It's got a little bit of everything that is really part of the whole American roots music scene. When the Beatles and the Stones brought American music back to America, you know, they'd learned and loved the same stuff that we did, but it came out their way. And that was just about the time we were able to get the band really on its feet and rolling, you know, the mid-60s. When we saw and felt the whole British invasion, first wave of British invasion musically, it really re-inspired us. You know, it's like, okay, now everything looks pretty legitimate. It had been years since Elvis. You can actually write and play your own songs and get on Ed Sullivan again. So it was really inspiring. So that, you know, we got rededicated and Suzy Q came out in 1968. That was our first hit. And had 17 radio hits after that. never had a number one single, but many number twos and several number one albums.
Well, this show you're playing in Great Falls will be cool because it's a fair show, and you guys can go out on the midway and get a lot of greasy food.
Yeah, get our Italian sausage.
Yeah, there you go. Fried, oh, yeah. We fry and bread that Italian sausage.
Oh, yeah, I tell you, fair food. I've eaten my share of fair food. but, you know, fairs are, you know, it's a tradition. County fairs, state fairs are an American summertime tradition. And the fairs are especially good for us because we get a really broad audience demographic. The Creedence audience literally is 8 to 80 years old now. And a lot of the venues, we play a lot of casino stuff as well. That's a whole new aspect of touring now is the casinos have great showrooms and they use entertainment, sports, you know, boxing and mixed martial arts and comedians and rock music to bring people to their entertainment centers. So, but a lot of times they're age limited. So we you know, they have the 21-year-old cutoff in a lot of cases. So we lose when we get to that sort of situation. We're pretty sure that we're not going to get our newest fans there simply because of their age. So fairs provide a much broader demographic for us, our true demographic, and they're, I think, make better shows.
Take me back to the studio where you guys are recording that self-titled debut in the late 60s. And
right.
What's one story from that writing and recording session that really sums up how it felt to be writing, well, not only such a timeless record, but also writing and recording in that era, like being as far as the differences in technology?
Well, all the songs on the first two Creedence albums had been audience tested. Now, we've been playing this stuff in front of in concert before we recorded it. So when we went in the studio, there was hardly anything that took more than two or three takes. And a lot of it was all one take. The stuff that we did, the first album, first two albums were 8-track, I believe. You know, it was 8-track on tape, analog. They had high quality microphones, and the rest was state of the art at the time. The microphones are still state of the art today, actually. They're so well made. Those microphones today are worth many thousands of dollars a piece. Of course, that's inflated money, but we really, you know, didn't use the studio as much as just to capture. And then as time went on, we went in and recorded, but we still did singles. And so after you do three singles, you've got six songs recorded, you know, A and B sides.
Yeah.
And then you just go in and record a few more, and you got an album. So that's the way Creedence worked. We just pushed AM radio real hard, and then the albums were, when they came out, were more FM. There was a, you know, four or five cuts, depending upon the album, four or five cuts that were new. But most of the other stuff had already been aired. Nowadays, of course, you know, you can record it in your bedroom without people.
I know that you guys have had live albums with Revisited, but do you plan on, you know, someday writing or recording originals under this moniker?
No. No, the whole purpose of the project was for Doug and I to get out of the house and have a music project so we could play some, you know, so we could play together. We had no intention of adding to the legacy of catalog of songs that Creedence recorded. I think diffuse, you know, the real focus of Creedence. You know, we're not trying to add to it in the recorded legacy part of it. The recording our live album was almost an afterthought, a request by fans. We had no intention of recording live, and you know, we made that album Recollection. Double live album. We recorded it in three nights up in Canada back in 1996, I think. And, you know, it was just we didn't have any idea how it worked. It worked out great, actually. It's a platinum album. But to add more songs to the Creedence body of work doesn't make any sense now.
What keeps you coming back? I mean, what keeps you from just deciding? I mean, you said you're 67. I mean, what keeps you from just saying, you know what, I'm gonna hang out and watch the birds?
Well, I love playing. You know, I'm a musician. I love playing. The experience, the interaction between musician and audience member and the band and the entire audience is the real satisfying one. You know, you don't get that charge doing anything else. Everything that I try to do now I try and pick things to do that offer unique experiences rather than trying to find a bunch of things that offer the same experience. So nothing else in my life fulfills the urge and gives me the satisfaction that I get when I'm on stage playing. When I'm scuba diving, I have I can completely bliss out underwater, and feel, you know, just how amazing it is to be in that environment. And I don't think about anything else. I'm not thinking about music. I'm not thinking about my checkbook. I'm not thinking about anything, except how cool that feels. And that's why I do it. Golf's a little more frustrating.
That never changes.
You know, I think the problem with golf is that I'm never really thinking about golf when I'm playing it. So, but I'm working on it. You know, and the rest of my time, I like to travel and see the world and experience and, you know, have experiences wherever I go. So when I'm not touring, I'm touring.
Talk about your relationship with Doug, because, I mean, you guys have gone to battle together for decades, and it sounds like he kind of looks at this at the process of performing these days probably the same as you do.
We're on the same page about a lot of things at this point in our life. Doug is about 12 hours older than I am. And so, we're just sort of joined at the hip in many ways. We have our own lives, to be sure, but when it comes to all things Creedence and just, you know, a lot of philosophy in general, we're on the same page. And we both appreciate that somehow we've been given another chance to do what we always love doing. And that alone keeps us going, you know, as a performer. People often ask, don't you ever get tired of playing these songs? And no, I can say that we never do, because the intensity that we put into it, because that's what it takes to get, you know, a expected feedback. You know, it's something that we get to do every night. When the music dies out on Tuesday, you know, it starts back up on Wednesday and or Saturday, and we get to do it again. And it's never perfect, but that's what you shoot to try and top the previous one. And you know, it's a whole process. It's a closed loop of you really do get back what you put into it. So we can appreciate that now at in our golden years, that and nothing else really matches that. You know, to give it up would really leave it a hole in our lives. So we with that kind of thought in mind, you know, we head to the airport and take the flight and get on the tour bus and do it again. And you know, to the outside, it looks very repetitive, perhaps, but from the inside, it's like many, many new beginnings. You know, every night, every city is another chance to goof off and get paid for it.
Bye.
Tune in every Tuesday at 1:30 p.m. for Open Mic. Our guest today was CCR bassist and co-founder Stu Cook, who will be performing with Creedence Clearwater Revisited this Saturday at 8 p.m. at Montana Expo Park. Tickets are $20 for reserved seating or free for general admission.